In this video, we're going to highlight some of the cytoarchitecture of the nervous system. And we'll start off with some quick definitions, since scientists insist on giving similar structures different names depending on whether they're in the central nervous system or peripheral nervous system. I'm Dr. Catherine Moore, the histology wizard. During development, we know that neurons migrate to specific areas, and then they coalesce in groups. So in the central nervous system, we call those groups of neurons nuclei, while in the PNS, we call them ganglia. And to confuse things even more, groups of neurons in the enteric nervous system are also called plexi. And as with many terms, there are exceptions, most notably the basal ganglia of the CNS. Bundles of axons are called tracts in the CNS and nerves in the PNS. And the CNS also has regions that have specific layers of neurons, principally in the cortex and the retina. Now we're going to look at some of the structures that we can see with basic histological stains. And we'll start with the PNS and peripheral ganglia, those collections of neuronal cell bodies. Here in this cartoon of a cross-section of the spinal cord, I've labeled a peripheral nerve, a sympathetic ganglion, which is ventral and lateral to the spinal cord, and this ganglion contains cell bodies of neurons that deliver information to the body about stress and danger and are responsible for our familiar flight or fight response. And this is a ganglion of the autonomic nervous system. I'm also showing a sensory ganglion that transmits afferent signals from peripheral receptors into the CNS. And because this ganglion has inputs into the spinal cord, it's called the dorsal root ganglion. And these ganglia are covered by connective tissue capsules, and they contain the cell bodies of pseudo-unipolar neurons. So these neurons have one axon that acts like both an axon and a dendrite, and they actually lack synapses. Now each neuron is surrounded by Schwann cells, and just to make things more complicated, these are sometimes called satellite cells, but don't confuse these with satellite cells in skeletal muscle, which are actually stem cells. Now enteric ganglia, or plexi, are small groups of neurons that are in the digestive tract, and they go all the way from the esophagus to the rectum. Examples are shown here with A and B in this intestinal H&E stained image. Now, note that they look kind of wavy and pale, and they're going to look a lot like peripheral nerve. This entire enteric nervous system, by the way, is often classified as part of the parasympathetic branch of the autonomic nervous system. But more recent work really is consistent with this being an entirely separate system. That is, it essentially can act on its own to regulate gut motility. Now, disruption of or lack of these nuclei can lead to digestive motility disorders, such as achalasia, where swallowing is quite difficult, or Hirschsprung disease, which can result in megacolon. Peripheral nerves contain axons of both sensory and motor neurons. And again, these are associated with Schwann cells, and the larger nerves are myelinated. Here I have a longitudinal H&E section, and these nerves have a very pale appearance, paler than smooth muscle, and they're kind of wavy. And note that these are axons, so all those nuclei that you see are actually Schwann cell nuclei. Peripheral nerves actually contain three types of connective tissue covering, and shown here both in this cartoon of a peripheral nerve and also in this H&E section. The innermost covering is called the endoneurium. This is thin connective tissue that has reticular fibers secreted by Schwann cells, and the endoneurium surrounds an individual axon and its associated Schwann cells. Now, single axons then bundle together into fascicles, and the perineurium surrounds each fascicle. This connective tissue layer is thicker, and it contains modified fibroblasts, and you'll often actually see blood vessels and a few immune cells within the perineurium. Finally, the epineurium is the outer covering of large nerves, and this is denser regular connective tissue, and it can actually be continuous with the capsule of a ganglion. So those are our three connective tissue layers. So now let's move on to the CNS. CNS has two main components based upon where neuronal cell bodies are found, gray and white matter. Here I've shown you a transverse or cross-section of the spinal cord. In this case, it's stained with Nissl stain. And remember, this stains rough endoplasmic reticulum and DNA and RNA, so for the most part, it marks the gray matter, which is going to contain the neuronal cell bodies. It contains also dendrites and synapses. Now, the white matter contains axons, both myelinated and unmyelinated, and there are a few cell bodies, but not many. White matter contains axons, both myelinated and unmyelinated, and only a few cell bodies. And because there are so many axons in myelin, this area actually appears white in fresh specimens. Now, both white matter and gray matter contain astrocytes, oligodendrocytes, and microglia. Now, the brain is organized in much the same way. In this Nissl-stained section of cortex, you can see both white and gray matter. But recall that the cell bodies seen in the white matter here are not neurons, but glial cells. The gray matter of the cortex and cerebellum and retina are then further organized into layers of neurons, but we can't really see these using standard H&E or Nissl stains. Now, in addition to the neurons and glia, the parenchyma of the nervous system, there are several other important CNS support tissues I want to touch on today. The meninges are a set of connective tissue layers that provide protection for the brain. Cerebral spinal fluid, or CSF, is produced in ventricles, and it bathes and cushions the cells of the brain. And the brain contains these ventricles that are lined with ependymal cells, and that they communicate with the central canal that extends into the spinal cord. So we're going to briefly review the meninges. The outermost layer of the meninges is the dura mater, and this layer is attached to the skull, and it's actually separated from vertebral bones by a space called the epidural space, which contains a little bit of loose connective tissue, while the side facing the brain is very smooth and lined with mesothelial cells. Now, the dura has blood vessels and sympathetic nerve fibers as well. The next two layers are often considered as a unit, and they're called the leptomeninges, which just means thin meninges, and they serve to enclose the CSF, a little bit like a sandwich. So you think about that top piece of bread, which is going to be the arachnoid mater, and its outer surface is adjacent to the dura. Thin parts of its inner surface are going to protrude in almost finger-like projections called trabeculae, and these will actually contact the pia mater. The space between those trabeculae is called the subarachnoid space, and it fills with CSF, which flows through that space, it flows down to the spinal cord, up to the top of the brain, and eventually returns to the blood through more protrusions of the arachnoid called arachnoid villi. And finally, our pia mater is a loose connective tissue that faces the arachnoid, contains a lot of blood vessels and nerves. More importantly, it covers the surface of the CNS and is lined by a membrane made up in part of astrocytes. So those are the three layers. Now, I just mentioned the ependymal cells of the central canal. So let's take a closer look at these cells. Here's an image close-up of the central canal of the spinal cord, and if we zoom in even further, you can appreciate the cells lining that canal. These cells are actually derived from neuroepithelium, and they are either ciliated columnar cells or they're cuboidal cells that have extensive microvilli. And these cells are important in helping with production of the CSF. They actually help move fluid from the capillaries into the ventricles to form CSF, but they also can help move metabolic waste. Now, the larger structure that produces and regulates the composition of the CSF is the choroid plexus, which I've shown here with a cartoon schematic and also in an H&E stain. The choroid plexus is formed by extensions of the pia mater covered in ependymal cells, and these extensions then push into the ventricles, and they're closely associated with capillaries. Fluid then moves from the capillaries into the ventricles, aided by the microvilli and cilia of those ependymal cells. Now, the final structure I'll describe today is the blood-brain barrier. The CNS does require blood supply. It has to maintain a very high metabolic rate. But at the same time, it needs to be protected from toxins and other things carried in the blood. So to accomplish these goals, the capillaries in the brain are specialized to have limited access. And this is primarily due to tight junctions between the capillary endothelial cells. So most capillaries in the body are what we call fenestrated. That is, the endothelial cells have spaces between them that allow a few substances to move back and forth in and out of the blood. And in contrast, capillaries that form the blood-brain barrier have tight junctions that seal these spaces so that substances have to pass via the cells, that is, via transcytosis, across those endothelial cells, which greatly restricts access. Other important components of the blood-brain barrier are the end feet of astrocytes and very specialized cells called pericytes. For more details on capillaries, the blood-brain barrier, and pericytes, watch my video on the vasculature of the cardiovascular system. Now with that, we'll wrap up our review of the cytoarchitecture of the nervous system. Be sure to check out, like, and comment on my other videos. Suggestions and topics always welcome. Thanks for stopping by.